And what we want to do is really have an informal discussion with some of the founding members or early members of AFRICOBRA and their descendants. In other words, who did they influence? How do we see that? How do we see that functioning? So we want to talk a little bit about the influences too. Not just how AFRICOBRA artists were influenced, but what kind of impact did they have on people like Raymond and Static? You know, that what first started as the coalition of Black revolutionary artists and evolved to the African commune of bad relevant artists.
It is all out of the head of Jeff Donaldson. Cobra, coalition of Black revolution, right out of his head. The switch is right out of his head too. I think it had something to do with the Black Panther Party though. A little bit. Because they were approaching everybody trying to figure out who was revolutionary. You know, and they called us some bad names. It make me cry, say it. Pork chop nationalists.
That's right.
Hurt you to your heart.
Yeah.
But the interesting thing about the whole thing, and I can't stress it too much, we're an organization of artists, and we are perhaps the least likely people to join together, artists. This is my piece right there. I've got several pieces in here that I'm very proud of. I was teaching at Northern Illinois at the time. Northern Illinois University. I ran into Jeff Donaldson in 1969. He said, try and get as close to Chicago as possible. I did. And my life has never been the same. I've taken a lot of advice from Jeff Donaldson. And it's all been very sound.
We know during that period, so many things were happening that were collectives, that were moving beyond the individual to our collective progress as a people. So you had an AACM, an Obasi, a Kaumba, an ETA, all of these things came from here. Napoleon as a dad in the woods, Chicago.
It didn't happen in other places. Wait,
no, it did not. So my question is to Napoleon, what do you think? Why did these things spring forth from Chicago?
Well, I have a theme that I believe, which is that if you grow up in Black Chicago, you have to make a decision to make a statement that you're not an activist.
You have to decide not to be one.
You have to decide not to be one. Because you are brought up an activist if you raised in Black Chicago. And so Jeff's understanding of that, I think, was in his DNA coming from Little Rock, Arkansas, Pine Bluff, Arkansas, and from the good down south to up south. And it's just, it's not easy to put it into words because it's a living entity. We do that sort of thing. We have family, and family is by extension because all of us have lots of cousins that are not a part of our blood relational family, but we will fight for them tooth and nail just like we would, and sometimes even more than we would some who are our actual cousins. So I would say that the energy and the spirit of collectivism, the sense of a community that deals with the sense of what a commune is,
yeah,
is about living as one, understanding the adversities and also the great wealth that we share and cherish and wish to protect.
It started as Cobra, then AFRICOBRA, the African commune. And I'm wondering, Dio, when you look at the work, that rhythm and all the rest? Did you just feel that kindred brotherhood right from the gate?
It was quite easy. Thank you, Anyeye. Can you hear me?
Yes.
It was quite easy for me, even though my elders who started the course are more close to my parents. But remember, our first start took place in Nigeria, 1977. It's coincidentally, probably not coincidental, that that's about the time I was a freshman at Yaba. And it's quite interesting, one of my freshman teenagers, it's a Professor Adeyemi is visiting. He delivered a paper here last week. He came for it and I forced him to stay. We've not seen each other since I left Yaba in 1983. Professor Adeyemi is there. The few things I will talk about will emphasize why an African in the continent got the message, so to speak. First, I introduced it, and Dr. Samela Lewis's book introduced it. I think some copies came to Ibadan, the town I was. And while I was buying my materials, I saw the book, just about two or three of them on the shelf. It wasn't a book prescribed by Yaba for teenagers coming in as a freshman, but what I saw was a black artist, African-American artist. And so I flipped through the pictures, show this diversity of styles. So the styles attracted me. While reading it, I knew of your movement. Now, I didn't know then that time will lead my path to America, more so to Howard University. But I should let you know, in Nigeria in the 60s, while this was going on, there was a group of young artists. Don't forget, we just had independence in 1960.
Yeah.
There were the likes of Professor Yusuf Grillo from Ahmadu Bello University, Bruce Enobra Kwaya, Ahmadu Bello University, and Demasun Woko, Uche Okeke. These were in the mid-60s, they were graduating, and they called themselves the Zaria Rebels.
Mm.
So if you link rebels, being a rebel and being a cobra,
and
the revolution begins. So their key was similar to AFRICOBRA's goal, which was look back, which is the Dr. Island Locke's policy, for black artists to look within them and back to the continent for inspiration. And so the names I named became head of departments in the School of Art in Nigeria, including where I went. Dr. Grillo became the director at Yaba Tech, and Dr. Bruce Anambrakwaya, I think, was in Benin, and he goes on. So I probably should leave it there now and let more people talk. But my influence started, and eventually when I came to Howard, meeting Baba Jeff did the rest of it.
Yeah.
For me, my journey is very similar to Brother Nelson and Brother Napoleon. When I graduated from the Art Institute, and when I was a sophomore there, I was grappling like we all did at that school with our artistic identity and how I wanted to my work to portray a sense of myself without bending to a lot of the westernized ideology. And so I had a instructor by the name of Bertrand Phillips, a wonderful artist from the South Side, who introduced me to AFRICOBRA, and it changed my life. It changed everything about what I do. When I learned the tenets of and the precepts of what you all did, the philosophies behind what you did, the community first nature of what you do, it spearheaded everything as far as what I wanted to do as an artist. When you look at this work in here, this is a phenomenally crafted art. And a lot of times people, African-American artists, they shy away from the innate things that make us who we are as far as the way we apply our craft, color, texture, rhythm. These things are innate in us. And so I embraced it, I lovingly embraced it after I discovered it, and I've tried to build my own sensibilities of what I like to talk about within those tenets. I have two pieces in the show that I'm humbly happy to have there. This is like, for me, showing with them is like you show up with your favorite person on earth.
Like with the master.
Wonder, like, you know, so, yeah. I mean, so this is an incredible, humbling experience, and for me to be a part of it on so many different levels. I'm just along with, I'm totally follow what they've done. I think what we're trying to do here, with me being at Southside Community Arts Center, is yet another leg of my journey. It's all a part of this. I'm humbled to be in this path, to walk in these aisles with these brothers and sisters. And we're trying to, once again, it's hard, like you said, it's hard for artists to do that. But I think it's more important than ever.
Yeah. You know, when you said that you were humbled to be a part of the show, as you know, we have a show right on the other side, Ken Killing Ken. And when James Pate came here to do his gallery talk and saw that his work was opposite the work of AFRICOBRA, he was just dumbfounded. I mean, that's not the word I want, but I can't come up with it. But he was so excited because he said he was so greatly influenced by AFRICOBRA and the work, and to know that he was right here sort of being a part of this. He felt as you expressed. Yes.
No, I simply want to say that we're honored to have this brother here. He's truly amazing. As soon as I was here about a month ago, first time I saw the work. I've made about 20 phone calls about this work. One of the most important ones, Bing Davis, thanking him for what he had done and suggesting that they be turned into lithography prints. Mm-hmm. So they can be many places, and that it can support itself in terms of how it has to travel.
Rahman, your expression.
My expression?
Yeah.
My expression and influence. For one, as you all may have heard, I grew up on the south side of Chicago. I operate as a public artist, as a mural artist, and as a fine artist, although my motives between the two is slightly different. As a public artist, I'm on a mission to save the world with art, to influence people to make better decisions and to rejuvenate their communities, create their own realities by creating art themselves. I'm pro people, each individual expressing themselves in public spaces and reclaiming back their community, especially since we're living in a world where all that has been capitalized, all that's for sale. And you pay taxes to stay in these communities the same way these corporations may not do, but you have a fair chip in also. I grew up looking at murals by Calvin Jones, Calvin Jones and Bill Walker in particular. I grew up looking at the mural. Exactly. I grew up looking at the mural off of Stony Island, the Regal Theater, 71st and Jeffrey. You know, it's a few more murals off that corridor right there that, you know, I remember those being done as a kid and actually set a standard that let me know that there was a standard by local artists as far as overall aesthetic, expression and message and function right there. I didn't learn that in my school, right? No one else told me that. I found it out on the streets myself just by looking at the world around me and wondering, why does my neighborhood look like this? You know, who are these people that are trying to make a difference? You know, and one day, how can I become one of these people? How can I become one of these artists? So I have my own path, I have my own world based off the era I was brought up in. I came through the hip hop graffiti era. I started off by doing that and evolved and developed a motive for actually still painting walls, a motive to be a public artist, like a sincere motive. A lot of that motive, believe it or not, came when I crossed paths with this individual by the name of Dr. Sidhar Weber. I worked with him. I met him through the Chicago Public Art Group. I was connected to work with him, and you know, very good guy, very strong personality, but on a level where like he basically addressed it, where like, you know, he basically bred it to me. Well, that is my function as a black artist to my community, is to save my community, my people, with art, being the counter art argument based off of what you see in popular media and popular culture. In other words, that's the reason why we have this Kill Ken show up right now. So it's a counter image of what you see in popular media and the way we're depicted, right? So it's at some point, since this capitalist art is made by other artists, there has to be some other artists to oppose that, if you will, to create a counter argument. It's nature. You know, it's supposed to work that way.
To me, when they first came out with that thing about revolutionary, I thought it was because they were gangster in spaces. You know, just coming up in that wall of respect thing,
exactly.
At 43rd Lane, we did not happen through a series of permits and discussions with the aldermen.
No, it didn't.
You know, you just looked up one day and it was going on. It was happening and everybody just captured everybody's imagination and it went throughout. So I think it's got to be a little gangster in an artist who wants to change the community. What say you?
It's true.
You absolutely have to be, because we did gangster that wall. You know, and we gangstered a philosophy, a manifesto, and a sense of being. And to borrow something that may not have been as successfully, from my perspective, done by a lot of hip-hop artists, is to change the narrative of certain terms, images, and so forth. That change happens by an affirmation of the journey as opposed to a response to something that sounds negative. Mm-hmm. Because you negate that which is negative by your affirmation of yourself. And so AFRICOBRA took the position of affirmation.
Yeah.
We've talked a lot here about a lot of things that's assumed. We're assuming Black excellence. We're assuming it. Isn't that interesting? And we're assuming love of our people. We're assuming. And that's the way I felt when I first joined a room where these AFRICOBRAs were in 1969. Because I'd been in rooms where the rap was great and the work was awful. Ooh.
And the reverse. Yeah.
Because when I was in Cleveland, we have a creative workshop. I was trying to call it at least, you know, Black Orpheus. It was creative workshop. But the brothers could paint. They're from American Greeting, and you know, everything I learned, I was like a sponge. So, what am I saying? I'm saying that I'm having a lot of fun now. This is glorious, really.
Yeah.
And thank you for showing up. I could talk all day long. I could.
Well, you know what I'm going to ask you guys?
Wait, one thing is very important.
All right.
In terms of art, John Lewis has a book, a comic book about the movement. Mm-hmm. Haven't seen it yet, just heard about it. It ought to be checked out. I'm interested in what art does on any level of time. And Faith Rangel, by the way, has 36 books, not 5 that you may think.
One of your other proteges, Turtle Only,
yes,
has really taken this to great heights through the New Age Black Comics,
yes,
and started that movement and organized the people who were doing that as well. I want to focus just for a moment on organizing and the act of being a part of a group, whether it's a commune, a collective, or whatever you want to call it. People often speak of artists as being people who have an individual expression and have the need to be individuals and just do what you want to do. And do you feel that you lost any individuality being a part of a collective? Or do you feel, you know, I am because we are? How did the organization itself strengthen or impact you in some way as an artist? Anybody?
Thank you. Yes. I joined AFRICOBRA 2 months after doing my graduate work at Kent State. So I was painting, thinking, reading, investigating. AFRICOBRA made my work more accessible.
My assessment is that, and this is from myself and extending out to the rest of the group, all of our personal identities became stronger as a result of our collective identity. No one has ever been able to go into an AFRICOBRA exhibition and not identify each and every one of us individually as our own aesthetic footprint, thumbprint. But that being said, that is the affirmative position that we take as AFRICOBRA, because our discussions about each person's work is not a diminution of their work or skill, but it's about elevating that. And so what I say to Nelson about his work is about raising him. What he says to me about mine is about the same thing. And so, and the same with Carolyn and Wadsworth and so forth and so on. So we take great pride in what each has to say about our work, because that in turn expresses the love. And it shows the direction in which we need to continue to grow.
The emphasis to for a young artist to be able to look at your colleague's work, you pin it on the wall, and for you to get close to an A, you should be able to, quote unquote, see what is not good in your view about that work, even if that's your best friend. You should be able to critique what don't you like, and at the same time, there's no work of art that is not good. You should still say what you like about it.
There's another point, too, because I've done critiques in the university for graduate students, and I've done critiques in AFRICOBRA. AFRICOBRA is really helping with the graduate students, because the idea with AFRICOBRA is, how can you make it better?
Mm-hmm. That respect even went as far as the Oshogo School. Mm-hmm. Now, the Oshogo School, founded by Ulibaya in the early 60s in the town of Oshogo, is more like a workshop. And to have brought taxi drivers, carpenters, and other artisans together and give them pen and ink to talk about stories and praise chants within their culture, and then end up having as great as Baba Jacob Lawrence in such a discourse all the way from here in India, and Baba Jacob saying that he learned from them, and vice versa, and they learned from him. So you're talking of artists embracing each other, which unfortunately, bro, our era doesn't seem to have. Well, we're trying to do something about that.
Well, that's the whole thing is the motivation that the artists of AFRICOBRA had to do their work was totally different than the motivations of a lot of artists now. And so when your motivation is to be a blessing to the community initially first, then everything kind of comes down from that. I mean, you can talk aesthetics, you can talk philosophies, but the love for the people is the first thing. So with us, we have to get back to that. And I think what we've been trying to do, Dio and I, at the Southside Community Art Center, is to once again harken back to those kind of things as far as bringing the artists together.
When I think about impact too, it you see that so many of the AFRICOBRA artists became professors, and as such had a chance to influence hundreds and hundreds of students. Let's talk about that for a minute. Who went where in terms of these influences? You know, as you went out and were in different universities, different communities, influences different students. Nelson, did you, was Massachusetts your next move after? What's your trail from AFRICOBRA?
I'm originally from Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn, New York. Then I went to junior college, Utica, New York. I went to Ohio University, went to Kent State, taught. I got out of Kent State just before the killings. I got an invitation to go to the University of Massachusetts Amherst with Archie Shepp, Max Roach, Diane Ramos and Dance, Paul Carter Harrison in theater, and me as a visual component in order to work on a 21st century thing without a name that would not be one or the other. There would be conglomeration or all things. The money ran out to investigate it quickly. So I did the mural program. And after the mural program, I did Drum Magazine. And that's white folk.
Mm-hmm.
I've been influenced by so many people. I'm a sponge.
And that Malcolm X community, gosh, I was here just last during KKK discussion with Peyton. And a sister hollered across the parking lot, not here, but over at the co-op in off of Lake Park. Napoleon, I look across and I said, well, okay. She said, you don't remember me. But I remember you. I was in your class taking weaving at Malcolm X Community College. And I said, no, I don't remember you, but I do remember the class. And I left here as a result of 1974 when a group of students who were here for the National Conference of Artists, which, of course, Margaret Earl was pivotal in that whole energy. And her position was that all everybody who came who was an adult practicing artist had to take their students to some other practicing artist in the locale where they were. So a group of students came by my studio and they saw that they were looking at these 10 foot by 12 foot looms I had in my studio, and they said, wow, what are you a weaver? Which is what I principally do in there, works in there that speak to that. And they asked me if I was interested to come to Mass College of Art to increase their black faculty, and of course, saying they increase the black faculty, of course, that's just right down my road, so of course I went. And I was going there for just 1 year, and I've been there 37 years, but not at Mass College of Art. I've also taught at Emerson College, Roxbury Community College, and my last 10 years I spent up until from 99 to 2008, I taught at Benedict College in Columbia, South Carolina.
Right.
HBCU. I always asked and hoped that I'd be able to teach at least full time at some HBCU before I fully retired from teaching. And I got what I asked for. I've been in Boston for 37 years and I've been directing an institute I started there in 1979, the Research Institute of African and African Diaspora Arts, which is an institution that has a library of over about 5,000 books and volumes of information on African life throughout the world. So we've done all kinds of programs. We've had Kente Cloth Weavers in Residence for a month. We've been Kente Cloth. We've been invited and did a project with Malanga Tana before he passed, the artist from Mozambique. And we've done great numbers of programs, collaborations, because I'm an independent entity with the community entity, the Museum of the National Center of Afro-American Artists that was started by Sister Elma Lewis back in 1969.
All right. Well, I don't want to dredge up old arguments, even though Nelson did say at the beginning that sometimes folks were referred to as push-up nationalists and the like who were interested in things cultural. But there's always been an issue, and they discuss it eloquently in Black World, about whether one was a black artist or artist who happened to be black and for what one's work should be used. And Nelson has a passage of which he is very fond that comes from Du Bois' World of Black Folks, and he says, I stand in utter shamelessness and say that whatever art I have for writing has been used always for propaganda, for gaining the right of black folk to love and enjoy. I do not care a damn for any art that is not used for propaganda, but I do care when propaganda is confined to one side while the other is stripped and silent.
Yep. The idea of propaganda is very interesting because if you can't identify it, it's generally going along with the norm. It's political. All art is political. You know, your favorite soap is political. And it has to be seen that way, and that's the way Du Bois sees it. I've been a member of the Du Bois Department at university for 35 years. I'm not a scholar on Du Bois, but I'm pretty close and I like what he's saying and saying. He thought that the race question would be over by the end of the 20th century. Isn't that amazing? What people are proving now is if you don't have a right to vote, it's not a democracy. And they only tried to have a democracy 50 years ago. It's a new way of thinking about it. The white vote for Obama was 40%, never higher. The white vote for Obama was 40%, 37 the second time. So, I like facts. I'm an artist, but I love facts.
Rodman, do you see it important to gather other artists to that cause? Are you going to lead by example? Or how do you see this happening, this proliferation of murals and ways of getting some other images in front of our young people where they have to see them, walk by them, and live with them every day?
I see it's important that artists come together of like minds to collaborate for the sake of the bigger picture. You know, it's just like what we're talking about is bigger than just one individual artist, one individual piece, and an individual sitting in the studio. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is that I work with other artists. I have some of all my best friends are artists. For the simple fact of where I met a lot of these individuals based off of their work. I like their work. They were my peers. And instead of being jealous or envious of them or intimidated by this other artist, I thought maybe it might be cool to have a conversation with this guy, you know, exchange ideas for the sake of actually getting better. As a matter of fact, that's actually what you pay for when you go to college. Mm-hmm. You know, that collaboration, exactly. why not bring that together exactly. without being in an institution with the guy that lives down the street from you that happens to do the same thing? That's what happened as an artist. We begin to subtract ego from your motive and begin to approach it for the bigger picture, for doing better art for art's sake on that level, you know? And that doesn't come by you looking at your own work all the time or just being in an isolated vacuum, aka your individual studio or your workspace. By doing that, you have to bring your art to the people. So with that, you get a lot of ideas that you normally wouldn't have came up with by yourself. You get more refined and developed ideas through conversation, right? So in other words, you may see things as being one way, but it is good to get an outside of a perspective right. on a lot of these concepts. When people see, you know, maybe a small group come together, that does influence by leading by example to the point of that you're doing the right thing creatively. Like, that is the right thing, to collaborate with other artists for the sake of influencing the rest of your community to maybe create their own collectives based off their individual talents. So everyone may not be able to sing or dance the same way, right? But, you know, if I paint, you paint, you know, we like painting walls. Hey, this wall is big enough for the both of us to do it. Let's combine ideas, you know, to make a better project that could last long right there. That counts.
Now when did, my name is Lowell Thompson. And I think that I got into the advertising agency business at the same time that AFRICOBRA started. 68, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, in June of 1968, I'm from the south side of Chicago. Robert Taylor Holmes, at one point, at about 7 years. But I got into the advertising agency business 3 months after Dr. King was killed in Memphis. And I became an art director, copywriter, a creative supervisor for some of the biggest ad agencies in the world.
Right.
I went the exact opposite of AFRICOBRA in right. some ways.
Right.
I sold Coca-Cola. You're talking about propaganda. I was in the business of propaganda for 35 years.
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Right. But I'm seeing this exhibit. I came back specifically here tonight to see who did this and that. That's you, right?
Yes, sir.
Steven.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is the first time I've seen you, right?
Yes.
First yes, time sir. You've seen me, right? And I'm looking at your stuff and I'm saying, this relates to me getting into advertising and what I did in advertising. Even though it's not about Coca-Cola, not about McDonald's, hamburgers.
Right.
But it relates to what I did and what I do. And I'm very interested in taking what I learned after 35 years in advertising and relating it to what you guys have done in academia and other places, and doing what Static said.
Mm-hmm. Right.
People ask me, what do you do? What do you do now? I say, I am in the business of saving the world.
Yeah.
Starting right here in Chicago.
Yeah.
South Side, right now. So I'm very happy to see what you're doing.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you.
We should all be aware, it's hard to underestimate what art is doing to you. When you go shopping, complimentary colors are on every area. That orange, blue, in order to get your attention. That on the meat counter, they put a yellow light. Bring that red up. You know what I'm saying? All the lighting, all the manipulation of visuals comes out of our arts. The whole idea of offset reproduction comes out of Impressionism. You know, you look at it close, there it is. It is, and talk about, see, I almost went into advertising, and I'm a little bit older, and they were talking about showing images so quick that you couldn't see it, but you'd go get the popcorn.
Subliminal.
Thank you very much. You know what I'm talking about? You tell me they ain't using it?
You know, no, not.
There's no tool that they have not used.
Right.
And it is not for our benefit most of the time. So this whole idea of being vigilant, I'm talking about organization and vigilance.
Right.
And a lot.
And I think, too, at bringing the beauty of us to what you did, because I think you're part, too, of a particular group of folk from Chicago who brought that to advertising. You know, you, Emmett McBain, Vince Colors, folk like that who represented just in commerce, but represented us very, very well.
My name is Jonathan Woods. I'm a filmmaker. Some of you guys know me, and I'm actually the person who was contracted by the disciple to put together the videos, video interviews of the members of AFRICOBRA. And I have to say that while I was editing and listening to the content in order to put it together, I was extremely struck by the type of calm, cool, focused, relaxed, thoughtful, educated demeanor that these black men had in these videos. It was amazing. I haven't seen or heard that vibe and desire to be those type of men in at least 30 years. It's just really saying that I think that as we talk about collectives and the community coming together, I think that today is different because we are all so inundated with art that so many different people want to grow in art and experience it in a different kind of way. So I wanted to know what you all thought of, if you will, the popularization of images and art nowadays.
Whoever wants to take a few seconds.
Your question is, what do we think about the popularization of images and art? Jonathan, that was the question.
Yes, and people's just personal access to just creating art.
For one, we're in an era now where you have handheld computers you can put in your pocket called smartphones. People tend to use them for the reasons in which they're not designed to do. They use them for in other words, you have information in the palm of your hands. You could just do a keyword search and find out who or what anything is, right? Here's what gets interesting. I'm going to tell you all something I noticed. Went down in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, about a month ago, because I was commissioned by an individual by the name of Dr. Kevin Harris at the Museum of Public Art in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He commissioned me to paint a two-story Frederick Douglass in South Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I spent a week working on this project. I did the wall by myself. The thing that struck me about this project was that as I was painting it, I had young people young people to elders that had no idea who it was that was King.
Wow.
They had no idea who Frederick Douglass was. Right. In the era of smartphones, where you just hop on your phone, type in, and here's the thing, that we, I even put his name on a wall next to the portrait.
Right.
Right, next to the portrait. Right. And it isn't that hard to get the portrait right of Frederick Douglass. He's has a very iconic image.
Right.
That was kind of jarring to me. To based off of us living in so-called information age,
yeah,
in which you have a computer in your pocket right now. So that being so, if fueled my fire a little bit more, to the point where like, yeah, we actually do need a new wall of respect, many of walls of respect, if you will, because like there's a real missing link between a lineage that's less than a generation before us. You know, let's just say, I think you have art itself is being used to sell trash, mm-hmm, for the sake of capitalism, meaning that artists are hired to create everything you see that exists around you, and as a means of creating more stuff for people to buy, and in turn, within a matter of years, it goes into the trash. Right, and this trash builds up. We have no way of replacing this, right? Like, so we have this cycle of creating waste as a means of making other individuals rich. That makes no sense. You know, at some point we gotta break that cycle and quit getting gained, you know, and kind of play that back to them. And a lot of that starts with the artists, you know, taking a simple stance, you know, making work that says something, making work to challenge that, making work to it's your personal self-expression. That's your argument. Instead of being a guy on a soapbox making an argument, you do that through your pieces. That's what kind of difference you can make.
One of my favorite quotes is by Ozzie Davis, and he said, "The responsibility of the black artist, regardless of ideology or any kind of thought process as far as who you are, the responsibility, and regardless of medium, whether it's dance, whatever, the responsibility is to bring to the people the sense, the scent of freedom. So the scent of freedom, you know, what does that mean? And what does it mean particularly to people that don't know that they need freedom when they're still enslaved mentally? So our responsibility as artists is to bring the scent of freedom to a people who don't even know that they are enslaved mentally. So, and that's because of the multimedia explosion of negativity that we combat as artists. So you have to first have a responsibility. It's a multiple layered thing to expose that, and to also show images that counteract that negativity. And to not think that that's something like some artists do, that's passe, you know? Yeah. That's something that's not important, because that's part of the deception with that mindset as well. So me personally, I believe that, you know, my mission is to do that, bring the scent of freedom to my people. And that's, I'm unapologetic about it. And I love craft, I love culture. I love creating work at the highest level and trying to work with other artists to do that. I think what AFRICOBRA did, as far as everything that they did, as far the bravery it took for them to leave their individual mindsets and practices and form principle. This is unheard of. This is unheard of. You know, so they are heroes, and I'm just happy to be sitting up here.
Thank you. Do you have a little time for me to just say something on it?
Absolutely. I think art is a language. It's either you have people who understand what you're saying or not. So we leave it to the audience. I think an artist is free to express him or herself and what they want to do. But of what value it is if you're not being heard. So in time, such an artist, if they don't have an audience, will figure it out and probably take a different tune. Personally, I will use this opportunity, in case I don't have it again, to say thank you for what your generation and your movement have done to me personally, and of course to other African artists all over the globe. I've decided to borrow from you as a movement in my work ever since I went to a black college. Mostly not to mimic AFRICOBRA, but because I noticed African Americans who were practicing Orisha worshippers. Yeah. I attended Bembe's and I was so blown away. I visited homes of great people who set the scent in their homes, just like my grandparents. So I was like, wait a minute, am I dreaming? And so I did that as an honor. Since I've done works to talk about my life in America, when Katrina happened, I did a Mississippi garden with an image of Nina Simone on it with the American flag, which talks about her. I just believe that if she were here, George Bush's stance on us being, I think what she called us.
Goddamn Mississippi.
No, she said that these are refugees, yeah, so to speak, which, right, which he corrected, yeah, but that I decided to do something on that. And finally, of course, when President Obama was elected, I thought it was a victory for all, even though he can't take us to the promised land, hopefully somebody else will. That I address in my work. The Trayvon Martin is what I'm working on now. I have a series of studies being prepared for it. I just feel these are moments for me to talk about how I've lived my life in America. I don't think I'll be here for long, but at least when people look back, my career was built here, and I've been lucky to be able to say, I show with the great AFRICOBRA. Thank you.
Yes.
One of the things I want to mention is that I wrote a course in 97 when I finished my studies, and the director said, you know that black stuff you're always bringing up?
Yeah.
He said, you want to teach that? I said, well, yeah. He said, well, why don't you go over to Black American Studies and see what they want to hire you and we can work with them? I said, hell no. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm an artist. I work in the art department. I have an art department. That's why I don't want to be bothered with it. Mm-hmm. He said, okay, calm down. So I wrote the course up, they accepted it. Since 97, I have between 60 to 80 students in my class every semester. In the summer, I teach between 35 to 50 students.
Right.
It was low this summer, I had 32.
Right.
But the thing is that one thing I noticed, it keeps coming up, this discussion about post-black. And as a professor of fine arts, in the course that I love my course because I designed the course myself. You know, and I talk about AFRICOBRA as part of that course. I even also do an AFRICOBRA workshop in the public housing throughout the Southern Illinois state. But the thing is that this idea of post-black is, I mean, you know, I need some help. You know?
Don't go with it.
You need a 12-step program.
You should have used the word that I heard coming out your mouth, ridiculous.
Well, I've used that word in a few others, but, right. Yeah, but I need to appeal to intellectuals, job educators.
As long as that pipeline from the schools to the penitentiaries
exactly
exists to the way it is, it ain't post-black. It's not post-black until the unemployment percentage is the same. It's always double in our community.
True.
Always. So, yes, there are those people that want you to think that it's, that it ain't about race no more, boy. You know what I'm saying? But that voice has always been there, and constantly. And it's just about gaining information. You know, as long as we have to fight for our right to vote.
Again,
yes. Mm-hmm. It's not post-black. Those signs didn't change till 63. I'm 75 years old. I have seen the signs. They are humiliating. It's nice that they're in the museums now. But
the mindset's not.
It was an art form. The whole idea of these black mammy things that they call black memorabilia did not exist during slave time. They didn't need it. Like they didn't need the Klan during slave time.
Exactly. They were reconstruction.
Reconstruction and on. In order to force this mind to do some weird stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Art has been used against us many places, many ways. We were trying to use it for us.
Yeah.
We know the elements that you have to do in order to combine them to do that. And brother was talking about the commercial use of it. Yeah, we're using on the fine, you know, but we're trying not to be too fine that the message is blunted. Because in the West, what I was talking about before about building this whole thing about the musicians and the arts, it's a layering aesthetic. We are into a layering aesthetic. They, by and large, are into a minimalist aesthetic. And non-human. And the big question is always about death with them. It is never about celebration of life. Their big question, whatever the field, from Hamlet on, is about death.
Darrell Williams, native Chicagoan, lives in New York City for the last like 30 years or so. Two quick questions, and mine will be very quick. The first is, the only place that I've seen these beautiful works, other than here, is in books.
Yeah.
What are we doing to get this work more widely shared? That's question one. And the second question is, who of today's artists, Nicolene Thomas, Kehinde Wild, Carol Walker, people of that ilk, who of those people would, had they done the work that they do today, would you have considered for AFRICOBRA back then?
Those particular artists, the trio you named, who somewhat fall under and embrace the banner of post-black, one would not have been doing that kind of imagery in 68.
That's right.
So, on what Nelson's saying in terms of skill, Kehinde Wiley, if he were in the space here, might have been considered, if he could have been able to be a part of a bad, relevant group of artists, as opposed to being an artiste. Mm. See, we deal with one of the significant change in that. We address ourselves as image makers. And that's a very, very wide space between image maker and artiste. So that's my response to, if they were back there then, first thing, they wouldn't be doing the work that they are doing. And if they were of the right skill and in the right place, it may have been a possibility.
There was a white group called Cobra.
In Amsterdam.
That was the other reason that we're changing our name. But that had more to do with it. Because in my art department, you know, I would say to my white colleagues that I'm part of Cobra, and they'd say, oh, the white group, you know, I got tired of that quick. But in terms of names there, I'm delighted to meet these brothers. I didn't know about them. This is really an honor. They've been passing the honors this way. But really, the cats are bad. And we really appreciate it. Because we know what it takes.
I've been an artist for about 40 years. Coming out of a background of politics, really. And I left that world because I saw who those people were, and then I compared them to the artists who I knew, and I made a logical choice. And this is to my point, because we are in an environment that reveres politicians as leaders of our community. Our whole culture and philosophy and thought process looks to that arena for leadership. And if we were taking the metaphor of nation, the arena of politics, of civil rights, of agitation, of protests, is really foreign policy. that deals with our relationship to an external force. Mm-hmm. Art deals with our soul, our spirit, our community, our domestic affairs. Mm-hmm. And that is where we are lacking, simply because we have not paid enough attention to it. We're so focused on who is getting elected that we don't pay attention to transforming our community and the power of art to do that. You know politicians, you've heard them, you've seen them. Name one of them who could sit on this panel. So if an assemblage of artists are the intellectual giants compared to those people, why is it that we are looking at them and looking to them? Why is it that we are not embracing an institution like DuSable, making it world class, making it the center of a community? Why isn't everybody a member? Why aren't we using the resources that we have to focus on our centers of power? You're asking, why isn't this work around? Why haven't we created foundations to contribute, to print these works and put them in every house so every child in America sees it? I mean, what does that cost? $1, $2? I mean, if we are artists, if we're about transforming, we need to be on another level of agenda that's far higher than any political construct. That's about transforming, that is about changing the world in our image. You say you're gonna change the world. You're gonna do that. The question is to what? And when I look around to ask, who would I trust to design and define what that is, it's always an artist. Mm-hmm. You know, it is never a politician. It's always an artist, because you have the vision, you have the courage. You are the only ones who trust your imagination, who use imagination, who have the capacity to look into the void and see a wonderful possibility. So I salute you. I salute you, Carol, for what you're doing here, bringing this together, this exhibit. Thank you so much.
Thank you for everything you said and said so well, so beautifully.
Good evening. My name is from Nigeria.
Are you the teacher of Dio?
Yeah, it's cool.
Yes.
And Dio chose to come to America and stay in Nigeria. We're better for it because we met us. And when I came in, I saw Dio in the studio. I was so happy, you know, that he's in it. You know, some of us who trained then are possibly truck driver now. Apology, there's no problem about that. It's just for existence.
Yeah.
Some of them are shoemaker or something like that, cobbler or something like that. But when I saw him in the studio, I was so happy that yes, this spirit is on. My contribution is definitely simple. I teach art at the Yaba College of Technology. It's one of the famous art schools in Nigeria. Of course, as a matter of fact, it's the first art school. Founded 1948, you know, and it's still been on up to now. I teach printmaking, illustration, and painting. Talk about desirables. Dio mentioned desirables. We have in the cities, we have some of the students that put themselves together. And funny enough, then we were colonized by the British. And the teachers, the professors, they wanted the line of action, the line of teach thoughts to go this way, but these students said no. As a matter of fact, it was that time that the political situation was growing up. Everybody wanted to have independence and all that. So these young students are really agitating that, look, our composition has to be this, not this. Our composition has to favor the agitation of our people. And so that was why Kojo Fosu, who was an art historian, saw the works of these young students and said, look, these are rebels, you know, and the name Zaria Rebels came up from there. And up to now, we talk about that in our history. We have the likes of Demas Nwoko, who painted Nigeria in 1959. As a matter of fact, Nigeria was coming up to get the independence in 1960. And this is a young artist from school. He painted three British colonial masters, very sad, you know, because they are leaving the country. Oh. And then and then you have the guards who are behind these three guys, and they were very happy that these people are leaving, as a matter of fact. Now, Dema Soko is still safe now in Nigeria. And we have UChicago. I am actually contributing to the fact that AFRICOBRA is doing a good job. Unfortunately, we've not had a group like that, but individuals, artists, have actually know their onions and know how they're serving the society, because the art is not just for the sake. It actually has to give a kind of message. It has to be evergreen. And people, generations unborn, must be able to know that there was an artist, you know, and somebody lived, and somebody have agitated for them. After all, this America that we talk about, in the 60s, it wasn't this way. We just want to thank God that, well, some people have fought actually through the pen, or through the brushes, or through every of the means that, but artist art is actually very significant in transformation of a society. And so the likes of UChicago, Obiora, the Chukwu, and all that, they really, really worked. And then I just want to say now that we've been very active in Nigeria. We talked about the apartheid era, and we talked about the displacing the military from power all over the world. I mean, in Nigeria at a point in time, it was the military, but the art tried as much as we put group of them together, and we would displace them from power, and now it's the democratically elected system. We talk about the Niger Delta. Niger Delta is actually reclaiming the oil-rich area from that the artist community were able to help in propagating that. I would talk about the Boko Haram. The Boko Haram is the latest one now, who are saying no to Western education. And the art is saying, no, we just have to get the art, we have to actually educate these people. And so, unfortunately, what we are lacking right now in that country is that with this type of art that is really agitating and doing well for the community, there have been no patronage at all.
All right.
Thank you.
I want to, we had two very powerful comments, and we didn't give the panel a chance to respond after Marvin. I think there's some commonality in these comments, too, about to whom we should be looking for leadership and who has the active imagination and the courage to get us to the next plane.